Why is it that Jamaica is experiencing an increase in earthquakes annually? Are you aware that based on media reports, such as this in 2021, Jamaica recorded 450 earthquakes? In August 2024, Jamaica recorded 165 earthquakes. As of November 2024, Jamaica recorded 270 earthquakes. This projected increase pushes Jamaica towards experiencing a region of 295 earthquakes by the end of 2024. I want you to keep in mind that based on historical records, Jamaica would have been experiencing the range of 200 earthquakes. So, on this premise, we are experiencing close to an increase of 100 earthquakes annually. Why is there this increase? When it's a case that I went through some of my research, what it is that is highlighted is that the tectonics, the geology, or the explanation around what it is that's happening is extremely complex. And on this premise, I find it very misleading that it is trying to be simplified that in the context of Jamaica's seismic relations, that it is, let's just say, left, right, north, south. When you look at this map, what it is that you're seeing are the following. One, Cuba is located above the Gonave Microplate or on the North American plate. Jamaica is located on the Caribbean plate. And there also exists a Gonave Microplate, where the southern boundary of it extends through the mid portion of Jamaica. Looking at the west of this map, we will also see the Mid Cayman Spreading Center. In other words, there is lava that is coming up to the sea floor within this region. Take note of this paper produced by Dr. Benford and Demets, where it is basically highlighting that there exists reactivated faults along Jamaica's southwest. And in their paper, what it is that they highlight are that one, they're gonna have a microplate, the southern portion of it does exist, and it runs through the east, straight through the west of the mid portion of Jamaica. And they are highlighting that there exists north-northwest to south-southeast trending faults along the Jamaica's southwest, which include St. Elizabeth, Clarendon parishes, to name a few. Another thing these researchers mention is that the southern portion of these reactivated faults are cut off, or they end where exists the South Coast Fault. And the South Coast Fault has primarily an east-west movement. Let me present you with another finding from these researchers. What they found is that in the Santa Cruz Mountains, Don Figueroa Mountains, as well as the Bear Plain, these regions being St. Elizabeth and Manchester and Clarendon, respectively, at the basement rock level, what these researchers find generally are or is volcanic rocks. Above these rocks, say for example in the Santa Cruz Mountains and Don Figueroa Mountains, there exists the limestone. But in the area of the Bear Plain, there exists alluvium. So what this is showing is that there is a correlation as regards to rocks that exist within the inliers of Jamaica, such as the Central Inlier and the Blue Mountain Inlier, that have volcanic rocks, as well as the fact that these rocks also exist within the region that is beneath the White Limestone in the southwestern portion of Jamaica. The potential relevance of this finding is, among other things, highlighting that Central Jamaica has its origin from volcanic activity. And this potentially extends to the entirety of Jamaica. Now, in terms of the depth to the base bedrock, these researchers indicated that they came across these rocks at a depth of roughly 2 to 3 kilometers. Now, in the context of Jamaica's felt earthquakes and earthquakes in general, the depth generally of these earthquakes range from the 20s to the teens to the single digit in kilometer depth. In other words, it is the zone of igneous rocks, or rocks that are formed from magma. It's worth mentioning that based on previous work done, it is indicated that the tectonic activity that predominates within the region of Jamaica, as an example, is as a result of strike slip movement, or the movement of plates rubbing against each other and not necessarily going underneath one or stretching another. This map provided by the United States Geological Survey generally highlights that, again, the movement of the Caribbean plate is predominantly moving east-northeast, and the North American plate above is generally moving west-southwest. Now, in this context, based on this, there should be a degree of rubbing against each other, yes, but there also should be areas of subduction, or basically sections of the plate moving underneath each other. In this diagram, we can see that along the region of Puerto Rico, as an example, there exists a trench. This trench is indicative of subduction. So there is a sinking at one section, and there is also a rise at another section. So Puerto Rico is an example of the rise, and the Puerto Rico trench is the sink. Pay attention as well to the fact that there exists a section known as the Muertos Trough, and this area is an area of, you know, depression. And this area, in my view, could be as a result of back arc spreading. So the Caribbean plate, as a result of its movement, more than likely is also producing a degree of pull apart. So there could generally also be, over time, some form of upwelling, similar to what it is that is being experienced or witnessed in the Cayman Spreading Center. I theorize that over time, Puerto Rico, as well as the other islands located nearby, can experience volcanism. Turning my attention back to Jamaica and the Gonave microplate, researchers indicate that the Gonave microplate, in terms of movement of its northern margin, will over time accrete under or on top of the North American plate. So that is basically suggesting that the region of Cuba, the southern end of Cuba that we can see, is along this boundary of the northern section of the Gonave microplate, will have the buildup of rocks or sediments that are from the Gonave microplate over time. Now, based on that information shared, it basically indicates that it cannot be that the movement of the Gonave microplate is, as is highlighted in this diagram, a simple east-west movement. And if you also look then on the southern portion that goes through Jamaica, we see that the eastern end, which is linked to the Enriquillo Planting Garden Fault, as well as the western end, Walton Fault Zone, have somewhat of a bend. This bend, otherwise known as restraining bend, is a culmination of strike slip or plate rubbing, as well as subduction or plates going underneath each other. The scientific word for this is known as transpression. So within the Blue Mountains of Jamaica, there exists the zone of transpression. And around the Montpelier belt in the western end of Jamaica, there exists also transpression. In other words, there is a degree of mountain building. What it is that you should also consider is that where there is building up of mountains as a result of a degree of subduction, there is also the extent of subsidence or areas whereby there is a drop down in the landscape itself or the height of the land. There could also be areas whereby there exists some form of stretching. Now, this kind of complexity is also highlighted in the diagrams that the researchers, Demitz and others have revealed. It's worth mentioning that since 2020, there have been at least two magnitude 7 plus earthquakes that have occurred either along or within the boundaries of the Gonave microplate. Similarly, it's also a situation whereby on the Jamaica mainland, since 2020, there have been at least two magnitude 5 plus earthquakes. Prior to this, the previous felt magnitude 5 plus on Jamaica's mainland occurred in 1993. Now, on this premise, what it is that I'm basically saying is that definitely the Gonave microplate is revealing an increase in the occurrence of moderate and above earthquakes in recent time. Why this is occurring, in my view, well, one of the reasons could be because of the multidirectional movement of plates that are along the boundary of the Gonave microplate. The North American plate could be moving much faster. The Caribbean plate could be moving much slower, relatively speaking. And within the scheme of things, the Cayman spreading center could also be providing a degree of pressure buildup as well along the western portion, Walton Fault Zone to say, to be specific. So with that being said, because of the multidirectional pressure buildup, obviously there has to be pressure release. I should also mention that it is also likely that based on the differential movement rate of, let's just say, magma within the earth, it could also be that is a primary factor behind the differential movement rate across the different zones of the Gonave microplate. In extension, it also shouldn't be ruled out that over time there could be a degree of stretching of plates, microplates within Jamaica or fault zones within Jamaica, and in extension, further upwelling of magma. That shouldn't be ruled out, in my view. How soon this can happen, obviously, we can't say. But what it is that I'll also further go into saying is that definitely we should be investing in the monitoring equipment, as well as doing the additional investment in the areas of research so that we can gather further insight on the various faults, quote-unquote major faults within Jamaica, as well as doing the necessary seismic analysis of the fault zones that exist and extend beyond the mainland Jamaica to further gather a better insight or knowledge about the fault kinematics of the Gonave microplate. All in all, because of the fact that we are lacking in research, we basically are also lacking in full understanding of the inherent factors that are resulting in the movement or the increased incidence of earthquakes.